I mentioned to you tonight the word Jonah. If you were honest with me, the majority of us would say that's the story of the big fish. And you would be correct about 20%. Because the book of Jonah is not the story of the big fish. The story of Jonah is much deeper than him being in the belly of the fish. And what I realized that Jonah being swallowed by the great fish is a symbolic way to talk about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. I understand that. There's a whole lot more to the book of Jonah than just those things. And so if you have your Bible tonight, I encourage you to open it. And I want you to look in chapter 1, beginning in verse 4, down through verse 12. And as we read through this passage, I want you to notice what I consider to be some difficult questions that Jonah had to answer. And as we think of the questions that Jonah had to answer, I want you to think about you and your life and how you would answer the questions that he was faced with. As we begin reading, it says, "The Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. The mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God, and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship, had laid down, and was fast asleep." Question number one comes. "So the captain came to him and said, 'What do you mean, sleeper?'" Think about that question. What do you mean, sleeper? And then the captain says, "Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish." Here it is, all of the sailors on the ship are doing everything that is within their power to save their life. And yet there was this one lone individual who had gone down and went to sleep as he tried to run from God. As if trying to run and hide from God can be accomplished. And so I think when we look at the question that was asked, "Why are you sleeping?" the captain is saying to him, "You should be involved in the very affairs that the other sailors on that ship was there." They were astonished that this one could go and could be asleep. But what about us? Could we not also be asked the same question? Have you been asleep? And when I ask you, have you been asleep, the question pertains to some areas that we need to be involved in. Are you asleep to your obligations? Brethren, as Brother Joe prayed, to look around, we have some tonight who are asleep to their obligation to assemble with us. There are others who are asleep to other obligations of sharing the message of the gospel with others. And I can go on and probably spend the next hour talking about obligations that we have according to Scripture. But a second question that we might think about, have you been asleep? How about to our opportunities? Where is opportunity? How many opportunities do you have every day to show someone that you are a faithful Christian? Can you count them? Everyone you come in contact with needs to see that you live for Christ. Have you been asleep to your enemy? "Oh, Satan, he's not going to bother me. He's not worried about little old me. He's worried about so-and-so." Rather, Satan's worried about all of us that are trying to be faithful to the Lord. Why does it need to work on those who are unfaithful? They're already in his army. So he's working on those of us who are striving to do what God asked us to do.
Are we asleep to our Lord's return? When Jesus comes, will he find us watching, or will he find us asleep? Challenging question about being asleep. You see, Jonah was asked, and by the way, as you read through the rest of the verses, and I'm not reading them all at one time for a reason, Jonah never answered the question. You're going to see a theme of that in a minute as we go through these questions. But a second question as you go on, as you come and you begin in verse 7 where it says, "And they said to one another, come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us. So they cast lots, and it fell upon Jonah. And then they said to him, please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us?" Question 1 of verse 8. Whose cause? Again, notice, Jonah never gives an answer. And we know why he doesn't give the answer to the question is because he's trying to run from the obligation that he has to go into Nineveh and to share the message that God had told him to share. Who is to blame for our misfortune? Who is it that is causing this event, this storm? Who is it that is causing this to happen when the lot fell upon Jonah? I don't think that was a lot by chance. I think that lot happened because of the power of God, because he wanted Jonah to have to answer, to get him to understand what he needed to be doing. And so as you go on, let us understand whose cause. It shows to me that every one of us that is assembled tonight, that we have a personal responsibility and we are going to be held personally accountable for our actions. When you go back to the book of Genesis, chapter 3, in the very Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve are there. And what does God say? What is this that you have done? Who was he asking? He wasn't asking the serpent what the serpent had done. God had already dealt with the serpent and the evil that he caused by casting him down. The question was directly asked to Adam and Eve. What have you done? Personal responsibility. Or you remember David and the sin that he committed with Bathsheba of adultery. When the prophet Nathan came to him and told him the story of the rich man who went to his poor neighbor and took the one ewe lamb that he had. And David said, the man who did that ought to die. And then Nathan said to David, what did he say? You are the man. David, you are responsible for that action. That's what you did when you took this man's wife. Are we defending the cause of Christ? But a second question in verse 8, what is your occupation? What, Jonah, do you do for a living? To me, that had to be an embarrassing question for Jonah, because now he is in the very crosshairs and has been caught running from God. Not by God, but by the sailors on the ship. And again, notice, he never answers the question. He never says what he does for a living. And so as I think about that particular thought, how about us? What is our occupation? Oh, I don't mean that you're a farmer. I don't mean that you are a school teacher. I don't mean that you work in a factory or you do some other type of job. What is your occupation? You remember the Apostle Paul says that we are to walk worthy of the vocation wherein we are called. What is our vocation? What is our occupation tonight? As a preacher, what is my occupation? Isn't it to share the gospel? I'm fortunate I get to stand before you. I'm blessed every week to be able to share a message. Well, multiple messages from God's Word. But what's the responsibility, your occupation, for lack of a better term, as a pew sitter? One who sits. Is it the challenge for you as one who sits in the assembly to put into practice, to take the things which are taught by teachers, preachers, and others? Isn't it your occupation and your responsibility to put them into action in your life? You see, we're all called to be ministers of the gospel. Jonah didn't answer that question. But keep reading, and I want to touch on these next questions very briefly. They're not in my notes. But he says, where do you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you? This question Jonah answers. He says, I am a Hebrew. I fear the Lord. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. I'd be scratching my head on that one. What do you mean you fear the Lord of heaven who created everything? How can Jonah, with a straight face, answer those questions that way? Did Jonah know that God had said, I want you to go into Nineveh, but I want you to spread a message of repentance? Did Jonah know that? Did God tell Jonah what to go into the city and say? Yes. And now Jonah says, I fear him. But he's cowardly hiding in the bottom of the boat. You tell me, and we'll both understand. How is that fearing the Lord? Wouldn't the real reaction, if he feared the Lord in this passage, to respect what God asked him to do and to go to Nineveh, wouldn't that have been the thing to do? So I don't see how Jonah could answer that one question and not answer any of the others and do it with a sincere heart. But another question is asked if you drop down to verse 10. Verse 10 says, Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, why? Why have you done this? Why did you cause this great storm to come upon us? What was it that made you think that way? Today we would say, what were you thinking? What is it, Jonah? Why have you done this? You see, the sailors, and rightfully so, they were upset with Jonah because he put their life in danger. When we look at our life today, things that we do, the ways in which we reach out and the ways that we act towards those who are around us, do we realize that we're not only putting our life in danger of judgment, but we're putting their life in danger of judgment? Brother Jonah, why? How about when we react? And when we have been commanded to do something just as Jonah was, and when we disobey God, who is it that we hurt? Do we hurt our neighbors? Do we hurt the lost? How about even those who are of the family of faith? Do we hurt some who are saved? And unfortunately, brethren, we hurt those in our physical family too often. Why did you do it? And then when you come to verse 11, the next question says, as they said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us? Hey, Jonah, what are we going to do with you? What are we going to do so that our life and our lives may no longer be in jeopardy? The sailors in that question were asking Jonah to be accountable for his actions. They were saying to Jonah, "You tell us what we should do to you." Wouldn't that be nice if our children would come to us and say, "Now, how do you want to discipline me?" That never happens, does it? You tell me how you want to be disciplined. I know when it was time for me to be disciplined, I tried to run the other direction too. Because I knew, and some of you that are older, you understand, you're going to understand exactly what I'm going to say. If I got in trouble and got paddled at school, which happened, well, I won't say rarely, but occasionally, it happened. Do you know what happened if my mom or dad found out? It was worse when I got home. I tried to run when I knew I was in trouble. I acted just like Jonah. What do you want us to do with you, Jonah? You tell us. And he answered this question. Verse 12, he answered the question and he says, "Pick me up, throw me into the sea. Then the sea will be calm for you. You throw me overboard." Jonah finally said, "I'll be accountable for my actions. I will take responsibility for what I have done." And so, you and I, just as Jonah, there's going to come a day when we are going to be faced with accountability. If you turn to Acts chapter 17, look at verse 30 and 31. There in that passage it says, "Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. Did not Christ say, 'You will be judged by the words I have spoken?'" That's what Luke is telling us in Hebrews, or in Acts chapter 17. There was a time when God overlooked things. But now, since Jesus came, everyone is now going to be held accountable. Or maybe we need to go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and look at verse 7 down through verse 10. Notice what Paul writes to our brethren at Thessalonica. He says there, "And to give you who are troubled rest with us, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not obey God and those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power when he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among all those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed." Do you see what Paul says? The day is coming when we will answer the question. That's the day. Or maybe we need to go back and we need to look at John chapter 5, verse 28, verse 29. John records these words. He says, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all those who are in the grave will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation." We're going to be asked. We're going to have to give accountability for our life. And if we are ones who are found who have been faithful, we're going to the resurrection of life, the gift of God. Or if we've been unfaithful and evil in our life, we haven't been obedient, to the commands of God, we're going to the resurrection of death. Condemnation, which is the lake of fire. Jonah was faced with tough questions. You see, we don't focus too often on that section. Out of all the questions that he asked, that he was asked, he answered two. One, he answered arrogantly that I am a Hebrew, never taking responsibility. Oh, how his attitude changed by the time it came to the last question. The last question showed that Jonah was willing to accept responsibility. Were they hard questions? Yes. Brethren, you and I need to ask the hard questions today. Today, the question is, what shall you do with Jesus? Will you become his child through an obedient faith, a willingness to repent and change from living the way of the world to living the way of God, to confess the name of Jesus as the Son of the living God, to be immersed with him in the watery grave of baptism so your sins will be washed away, so you can walk and enter into that state of eternal life? Or have you done that and life hasn't been what it should be? You need to ask yourself some questions. You need to ask at the end of time when it comes. Remember, the question is going to be reversed. It's not, what shall I do with Jesus? The question will be, what will Jesus do with me? And if you've been unfaithful, the answer is easy. He will condemn you in the resurrection of condemnation to an eternal punishment. Tonight, you have opportunity to come home, to make amends for what's wrong in your life, repenting of sin and confessing those sins. Will you let your brethren pray with you, pray for you? You know what your need is. We're here to encourage you to live a faithful life. We're going to stand and sing a song that will encourage you. You take that step and you can come and make your life right. And do it right now while we stand and while we sing.